that my positive emotional state is dependent upon another person standing right here in this spot and acting in a very particular way and saying the right words. How much agency does that give me over my life? Not much. The answer to this is exactly what we've kind of been playing through. Visualize it worse, which is fear desensitization. Take that situation where you're feeling jealousy and then, you know, say it's with another person. Hold on a second, I need to go do some processing. Request that time to separate from the situation to do your own homework. If that person responds negatively or hostile, you now know everything you need to know about that relationship. You don't need anything else. Wait a second, was I in that relationship simply to get my fix? And I had to ask myself that question, and I don't actually have a full answer for that. Was I in a marriage simply because I wanted someone bonded to me so that they couldn't escape, and that would force them into a situation where they would choose me all the time? And the answer is probably yes. Jealousy is a fear response to a perceived threat. Jealousy is not about their behavior. It's not about their actions. It's not even about their intentions. It's not the why or the how or the wherefore or which three-letter acronym we can assign to them as a psychological assessment. None of that matters. What matters is that, like, their actions hit my nervous system and my nervous system interpreted that as a threat. Why? Welcome, everybody. My name's Kirby. Today, the topic's on jealousy. What is it? How does it work? The quick summary is, I'm Kirby. I'm the author of the Two Mind Method. These are the three cornerstones. There is a fourth and maybe a fifth. The fifth one is actually wrapped up in here. It's weird. It's how these two come together, and I actually have not talked about that since the Lulu's days. So I'll come around to that. Cornerstone number one, the five pillars of attachment from the work of Daniel P. Brown, felt safety, attunement, support while dysregulated, express delight, and autonomy. And the premise here is that we're born with the fundamental craving of I want to be wanted, chosen, and prioritized by my people, my community, my family, whatever. That's just a core craving inside the human nervous system. These five pillars are how you manifest or how you evoke that feeling in a person. So ideally, a parent would do all five pillars in adequate measure to any child, and then they will end up with a secure and healthy attachment system, which is like giving them a superpower. In my opinion, there's no greater gift we can give a human being than a secure attachment system. If there's a lack, this one, you end up with a dysfunctional attachment system, which leads to the hunger, craving, and longing for that which we didn't get. And that usually manifests in being jealous. All this is based on a fundamental premise that I kind of came up with through my research, that human beings rarely, if ever, behave as a single autonomous entity. They are always bouncing back and forth between this calm, regulated, intentional, thoughtful, forward-thinking human being. Oh, I really want to have coffee in the morning. I don't have coffee right now. I need to go to the grocery store now. And it's like, oh, what kind do I get? And how do I want to grain it before? That's all forward-thinking, predictive modeling stuff. Whereas the other brain, the child brain, which subconscious inner child, is down here controlling the emotional control panel. He does not have forward thinking. He just pushes the button and says, I want the coffee right now, damn it. And I'm gonna fill you with all sorts of emotions, positive or negative. Well, probably negative if we don't get it, and positive if you do get it. And so these two minds are in this kind of eternal dance inside us. And God, earlier in the process, when this first started coming up, I was just like, what a pain in the ass. Why can't I just be this one all the time? Like, why? But later on, as again, I continued researching, I find out that there's like very strong evolutionary advantages to having both. Like, if we could just wave a magic wand, you know, Homo erectus, whatever, and just say we get a whole generation of kids that are just the upper mind, the population would die. And same here, if we do only the lower one, it would be, well, we'd basically be primates. I mean, we'd be like lower primates, chimpanzees. We'd be chimpanzees, that's what we'd be. We would be hairless chimpanzees. And if you've ever seen an angry chimpanzee, well, you'd probably be terrified. And that's the way it works. And so it's like we need this part to tone the vicious, slaughtering anger that comes up from down here. We need this part to kind of calm that so we can actually have civilization, so we can create safe environments, so we can actually rear our young in a safe way, and then, of course, take over the planet, and et cetera, et cetera. Last cornerstone, trauma. This one's probably the most uniquely mine. Like, I started with this idea, like everyone does, that like trauma is something that happened to me. I've got it, it's some kind of dark energy field, emotional thing, whatever, right? It's this, it's like a thing that some people get. And, you know, bad things happen. And then I get this like dark cloud inside me that like won't ever let me be happy or whatever. And I don't believe that to be at all true anymore. Like, trauma is a reliable physiological process that's basically in everyone. And it's just what happened afterwards that allowed them to integrate. Because the way I say it now, trauma is nothing more than a moment where you learned a lesson. That's it. It's just that that lesson was so existentially threatening that the entire nervous system created a whole latticework of defense mechanisms to say, let's never ever experience that again. And those defense mechanisms are actually what people are labeling trauma. It is not, that's not actually the trauma. That is the reactive response to really, really fast processing system seeing stimulus out there and saying, that's enough, like mom, dad, snake, bike accident, stock market crash, whatever. That's enough like this thing that was existentially terrifying that I'm gonna activate the whole system and I'm gonna hijack and we're gonna shut off the higher brain and just survive. And that's what happens. Trauma is nothing more than a survival response to a lesson learned about a threatening event. And so there's a whole bunch of stuff neurologically about how it sits in the brain, turns off higher brain functions. I can talk more about that. The fourth pillar, cornerstone, which I don't have a slide for yet, is like, how do we fix it? How do we improve the system? How do we bring a person that has been unlucky or learned a lot of unfortunate rules or unfortunate lessons? How do we help that person return from the brink of insanity, of chaos, of terror? It's not even insanity, and it's not chaos, it's just terror. How do we create an environment where that person who learned a terrifying lesson and now many, many, many aspects of life are now connected to these terrifying lessons, which is a process called fear sensitization. How do we take someone who's suffering from fear sensitization and help them, like shepherd them back to the place where they're regulated, they have a chance of happiness, they come far enough back from the brink that they are like, oh yeah, play is a thing. Because play goes away. Like, this is another one interesting. Gabor Mate and a few others. Hi, welcome. Gabor Mate and a few others have been hammering on this one recently, and it's beautiful, is that like trauma and play are on this spectrum. And that when you learn lots of lessons, or even one big one, or many, that are existentially terrifying, your body goes deeper and deeper into a state of vigilant defensiveness. And vigilant defensiveness does not allow you to play. Vigilant defensiveness does not allow us, half the time, it doesn't allow us to connect. So play and trauma are like opposite ends of the spectrum. And I've definitely lived this. Like, when I first heard it, I was like, what are you talking about? And then I thought about my own life, I'm like, oh yeah, 100%. You get to this point where you can, this is for all you video game players out there, you can engage in activities that are labeled as play, like video games, board games, dancing, et cetera, et cetera. But what you're actually doing most of the time is you're either using it as a numbing agent, which is if I sink into this virtual world that goes on to infinity and I have to figure out how to like hammer wood together and build blocks and whatever else, that consumes so much of your brain that you're now completely dissociated from real life. And when you do that, you get to feel regulated. You get an escape from all those scary things over there. And we call that play, but it's really a numbing agent. There's definitely some gray area there. You can have things that you love and you're passionate about and you're excited to get involved with, and it is not necessarily a numbing agent. Really, there's no person that can answer that question except for you. So how do we answer that question? And it's like, it's right here. It's how much attunement do I have with my own inner child? Can I ask my inner child the question, am I dancing bachata 8 times a week as a way of numbing out from real life? And if you get no response, keep asking. If you get a response that's just like, no, it's probably a yeah. Yeah, how much defensiveness is in the answer? The defensiveness in the answer will actually tell you the answer more than the words in the answer. And that's actually something that, you know, free advice for everyone when you're interacting with someone, especially a romantic partner, that how they communicate and how they speak is communicating more than the words. Don't listen to the words. Listen to what's going on. Okay, anyway, how do we, the fourth cornerstone, which I don't have yet, how do we bring someone back from the brink? That's been an ongoing bit of research, but it has been very, very fruitful. Boy, Cliff Notes version is fear desensitization. Wow, that's the first time I've ever said that, but it totally, that makes sense. Fear sensitization is the reaction to traumatic events. Fear desensitization is a pathway back to wholeness. And so how do we do fear desensitization? And that's what they call exposure therapy. But I have a very particular way that I do it. And so someday I'll get a slide for that one. All right, so that's the summary of the four cornerstones. First off, I've been thinking about, like when I was thinking about this, kind of brainstorming this class today, I'm like, I'm usually really big on terms and defining stuff, but I'm like, well, how would I define jealousy? And I'm not sure I have a solid answer for that yet. But I do know that it's very interesting to think about the difference between jealousy and envy. And I'm totally open to the floor if anyone in the peanut gallery has thoughts on that one. So, but I do think that jealousy and envy are probably two different things. Envy being, I'm thinking of envy as being that person over there and I have something in common, but I see them having a better life, better experience, more cash, more better family, better whatever, right? There's that one. And the jealousy is more, this is something that I feel like I have, and I have a reaction at the idea of it leaving. Well, we're both guys, right? We're both guys, we're both roughly the same age, we're both blah, 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 right? And I mean, if we really want to get into meticulous of the details, but I don't think we need to, but in that one, my brain says, you're both guys. I mean, I'm mapping my own situation, my own memories into what you just said. And it's just like, I'm here, here's a person that I care about, that I want their attention. I see their attention going somewhere else. And this is where jealousy and envy smash into each other. Because it's like, I see why her attention is actually going that way. Like, there's a part of me that recognizes that in this particular domain of life, he is better looking, more attractive, stronger, fitter, better job, blah, 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 right? He is better than me in whatever domain I'm looking at, right? That's gonna be the envy part. And the jealousy part is now on my side, that it's like, here's this thing that I care about, that I'm holding on to, that I'm clinging to, and it looks like I might lose it. And then it's just like, and now I've got all these negative feelings. I think we can safely say that jealousy is associated with negative feelings, negative valence emotions. But I mean, if we're trying to get into a definition of jealousy, we can be like, okay, we can at least start there. There's definitely some kind of negative emotion. That there's this, that's like, there's something we have in common. I'm a guy, he's a guy. I'm a woman, she's a woman. And then they have something that I don't have. And that to me seems like it's envious. But these definitely are stirred in the same pot. Like, you know, it's rare that emotions are like discrete, separated like that, but if we think about just the range of emotional expression, these two are both swimming around in the same pot of soup. I kind of want to focus more on the jealousy side. Maybe if we have time, we'll spin around to the envy one. Because, yeah, as someone who used to be fiery jealous, destructively jealous, and then doing loads of work, thinking I've made progress, and then straight into a relationship where the partner is destructively fiery jealous and being like, oh, this is what I was doing. Like, oh, this is what it feels like to be on the other side. I'm like, oh, wow. Thank you, universe. No, thanks. Thank you, universe. So I've definitely been on both sides of that. So what is it? Any guesses? Any hypotheses about what jealousy is and where it comes from? Who here has felt jealous? Yeah, because what you're talking about there, in my world, it's when the two minds begin to enter into the dance and they're actually dancing together instead of just pushing hijack buttons and taking over and suppressing each other. But in the psychology world, they have this idea of valence, and valence is kind of like direction. Like if you think of a needle, it's like, and we just say positive valence emotions are the ones over here that basically people generally describe as being positive. And then negative valence, of course, are the ones that like we describe as being like uncomfortable and negative, right? And then when we can kind of do enough work to get beyond that, we get to this place where we're just like, oh, they are really just, it's just an information stream that's coming into my system, and it's pushing me, it's generating a chemical cocktail that I'm going to interpret as positive because it has a purpose. And the purpose is whatever is down there driving this bus wants me to move closer to that thing. And that's why I say it, is that positive emotions motivate us to move towards something, negative emotions motivate us to move away from something. And so if I see this person getting ready to walk out the door and I have this flood of negative emotions, it's because my inner child is saying threat, threat, threat. We are about to lose something that we need to survive. Don't let that happen. And now we think about the standard tropes about someone who's like insanely jealous, you know, acts of, you know, violence, or what do they call it? Yeah, they actually call it acts of passion. A stupid name. Where they go crazy, right? Temporary insanity. I walked in, I saw my person, you know, sitting on the couch with someone else or whatever, and I just like, they just go crazy and they break windows and, you know, blah, 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 whatever. And it's like, that is a perfect example of the inner child hitting that hijack button saying there's some threat going on here. I cannot let this happen because I need to protect myself and I will destroy the world in order to do that. Definitely destroy my relationships, which I've done. Okay, anyway, if we look at jealousy, it comes down to that, is that there's something going on here that I interpret as a threat. That's it. Here's a person in my life standing next to me, and they want to make a choice. They want to do an action. They want to take an action, or they're exhibiting an action. So the hypothesis you're coming at, and I'm familiar with this one, is that like in order for that person to leave, they must have reached some point where I am no longer meaningful to them. I am not being prioritized. I am not being chosen. They're choosing something else instead of me. That's the idea, right? This comes up all the time, and I tell you, it dominated my life for a long time. So, let's test it. And Kirby's testing logic. Is it possible for a human being to walk out that door while they still value you greatly? If the answer is yes, then your logic has been completely disproven. It is not always true that for that person to walk out the door, they have to devalue you first. There are other factors at play, and that's just the way it is. There are other factors at play. And then we go another layer deeper. We say, let's say they did devalue me. They are choosing somebody else. They are assigning me a low priority in my life. Let's say that's true. And in my world, this is actually how we solve it. Let's say I'm married, right? This actually happened. And then they're choosing to value somebody else over me. right? Why they chose to value that is not my business. That's the separate autonomous human being, right? Any digging around or justifying or internet tests or whatever that I do to try to get more information on that, that's all a distraction. That's just distraction that I'm going to use to basically activate my own wounds and beat myself up more. The question I need to ask, if they are walking out the door towards someone else, I was like, why does that bother me? So then we come to the next question. Is it possible to be standing here where I'm standing, to be with a woman that looks like that one, who's walking out the door, and I don't care? Is there any person on earth that would stand in my shoes while that person's walking out the door and not care? And the answer to that is yes, always. So that means it's not the fact that she's walking out the door, it's something else inside me. There's something inside me that is creating a bunch of negative emotions at the thought of this person leaving, at the thought of being abandoned, at the thought of being devalued. Am I making sense? So then we jump to the point where we say, okay, what is this thing inside me? It has nothing to do with them because it never has anything to do with them. What is, okay, so she's getting ready to leave. I'm feeling all this pain. Now, of course, if the pain is peaking up and taking me into the place of overwhelm, then my brain won't have the ability to do this processing. I won't have the ability to ask these questions. All right, so please understand that, like, that's one of the fundamental principles of the two-mind idea, is that, like, if the subconscious is so threatened and he hits that hijack button, my brain's off. And so we need to come at this a different way. But we're gonna stay in the place where my brain's still functioning. My brain's still functioning, I'm seeing this person walk away, and it's just like, I don't want that person to go. Okay, why do I not want that person to go? I want them to stay here. Why do I want them to stay here? I want them to be giving me their attention. I want them to be choosing me, to be prioritizing me. And I don't want them to do it because I asked. I want them to do it because they want to. How many times have we been in that fight before? If I ask you to do it, and then you do it, I'm like, ah, damn, now it doesn't mean anything. Like, now you're just following directions. I want you to want it. I want it to come from your own initiative. Okay, so now, here's my partner who's, you know, looking at some cute guy down the road or whatever, and it's just like, I don't want you to leave. I want you to stay here. I want all your attention. I want all of your attention. Well, maybe not all of it, but if I dig down really deep, yes, I actually do. Okay, just a sec. And now it's like, so I want all of your attention, I want to be wanted, chosen, and prioritized by you, and what happens? Okay, let's take a second and imagine that that partner gives me exactly that, and it's like, haha, it feels so good. Wait a second. So I get all these good feelings if this person stands here and acts in a very particular way. But as soon as they threaten, they don't even take it away yet, they just give me some hints that they might take it away, now I crash into a big negative emotional state. Are my emotions dependent upon that person's behavior? Yes, 100%. I am now in a dependency dynamic that my positive emotional state is dependent upon another person standing right here in this spot and acting in a very particular way and saying the right words. How much agency does that give me over my life? Not much. Does that make sense? We have to get out of the dependency dynamic. I have to get to the point where I say, you get to do anything you want to do. You get to go anywhere you want. You get to kiss anybody you want. You get to do whatever you want with anybody you want. And at no point will I judge you for that. You will never get shame or blame from me for that. However, I get to choose how close I want to be to this situation. And my closeness might be out the door and fly to another continent. I've done that one too. Right, because like in the past I've talked about this with people and I've just been like, but Kirby, what you're saying is like I have to allow them to do anything they want? Yes. Because look at it realistically for a second. Did you ever truly, honestly believe that you could disallow that person? No, never. Unless you're going to get steel bars and handcuffs and build a bunker under your garage and lock them in it for 16 years. Please don't look that up. Unless you're going to do that, you cannot disallow that person anything. So why do we live in this dream that, like, I get to basically vomit out my negative emotions at you and kind of smash you into compliance so that you'll behave the right way so that I get my good feelings? And this is, like, this perspective changes lives. I see it happen all the time. It's that, like, give them every single chance at autonomy. And it's not just you're allowed to, but it's like I celebrate you making the choice that's most aligned with your values, your needs, your desires. I celebrate that. Maybe it doesn't align with me. Maybe I get all sorts of negative feelings when it happens, but my principles and my value and my agency say I celebrate this because I want you to be you, 100%. And then that person goes off and then they come back. They did not come back out of any sense of obligation or honor, blah, 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 right? I mean, I guess religious cultures can, like, tweak that a little bit. But in general, giving the person full rein and full permission and full freedom and celebrating it and everything, and they run off and whatever, and then they go down the street and they come back and they say, this is actually where I want to be. You're just like, awesome. Like, I've now just been super chosen. Because when you really get down to it, mom didn't really actually have a choice in choosing me. And that's one of the reasons why we have so many people with fucked up childhoods, is because you get people that basically get into the parental dynamic and they're just not ready. Not ready, they're not informed, they're not practiced. But I strive to change. But in that way, it's just like, you know, if I'm 24 months old, we don't have any of this in our brain yet, but let's just say, at 24 months old, mom has the freedom to walk away. Yeah, and then she comes back. It's like my brain wouldn't even register any of that. But as an adult, where this person literally has every choice in the world at their disposal to do anything they want, and they choose to stand right here, then I'm super chosen. That level of chosen is actually more powerful than the chosen from a parent. When you have full permission, you're short-circuiting the rebellion dynamic. Now, some people will go anyway, right? That can get complex at the teenage years. But as an adult, it's not as complex. But, like, I don't know about you guys, but I've been in relationships where the person's like, I'm going to go fool around with that guy over there just to prove to myself that I can. And it's like, and then they come back and be like, well, that doesn't feel very good, right? I'm not sure I want to be, you know, that was early in my days. I couldn't end relationships well. But yeah, I mean, it's just that, like, that's the kind of thing that you would say, okay, let's just jump ahead. Like, my brain's already on it. I'm trying to do this thing where I'm like, I'm saving the big payload for the end. No, it's not how it works. My brain's here. The answer to this is exactly what we've kind of been playing through. Visualize it worse. Which is fear desensitization, the fourth cornerstone I was talking about. Take that situation where you're feeling jealousy and then hold on a second, you know, say it's with another person. Hold on a second, I need to go do some processing. Request that time to separate from the situation to do your own homework, right? If that person responds negatively or hostile, something I say all the time, you now know everything you need to know about that relationship. You don't need anything else. If you say, I need to come over here and do my own work on something so that I can process my jealousy or find my wounds or whatever, and they say, how dare you, you're abandoning me, chances are low that that will go anywhere well. So anyway, let's say I take my time, give me a second partner, I need like a week to process this, and then I come into my own personal time and I wake up in the morning, 30 minutes, after waking up and 30 minutes before sleeping are the two most effective times because the subconscious is in a high state of pliability. And you come into this time period and you wake up in the morning and you're like, oh, I need to do those exercises. Like, what's the exercise? It's like, okay, I'm going to sit here. I'm going to imagine my partner. We, like, just finished breakfast. And then she's got to leave. It's like, ah, what do I feel? And then whatever you feel there, sit with it, process it, allow it, get curious about it. What is this coming from? Why? What am I so afraid of? Answer that. Do that a few times. Then turn up the volume and say, okay, now she's leaving and she's saying she's going to go have lunch with a friend. And then turn up the volume. I'm going to go have lunch with a guy friend. Turn up the volume. I'm going to go have lunch with my ex-boyfriend. Turn up the volume. It's like, I'm going to go have lunch with my ex-boyfriend. Then we're going to go to his hotel room and have sex. Turn up the volume. Like, there's always volume that you can turn up. And in every single situation, you can sit there in this visualization. And because the reason we do this is because it's never, ever, ever about the other person. It's about my wounds. I do this exercise to try to provoke my wounds into getting so damn loud that I can't hide them anymore, because that's what we're doing most of the time. All of this is based upon a fundamental assumption, which keeps proving to be true, is that we have wounds, we have fears, we have discomfort and terror that lives inside us. And what we've done as adults is we've figured out a vast, complicated, interlocking, very effective ways of keeping that fear down. We distract ourselves, we numb ourselves, we hide, we lie, we spiritually bypass. There's a whole bunch of things. And so when I was in the middle of this, I found that basically I wanted this quest. I was like, I want to try to find all the ways that I'm lying to myself. And I want to try to find each one of them and disassemble it and make it not happen again. This is Alan Watts and some of the philosophers will talk about. This is kind of connected. I hope people get it. They said, Alan Watts is famous for saying, trying to destroy your ego is like the guy who's hunting rabbits that walks into the forest with cymbals. Clang, clang, clang. I'm hunting rabbits. Clang, clang, clang. If you go looking for your ego to destroy it, it will hide from you like a pro, because that's what it does. And this is the same thing. The defensive mechanisms I have inside me are there to protect my ego and my sense of safety and threat and all that kind of stuff. And it's like, if I go trying to disassemble each way that I'm deceiving myself, it's like this, it's like the magician that's just the, you know, pulling the scarves out of the hat. So I said, okay, that's not working. So what I said was, okay, let's say I do it the other way, and eventually I figured out this approach, which is like, I'm going to go deeper and deeper and deeper into the visualization. I'm going to keep turning up the volume of discomfort. And eventually I'm shuddering. My hands are shaking. My solar plexus is quivering. I feel like I'm going to vomit. Like, my whole system is in a state of activated duress. I can come back anytime I want. So I do. And I come back to stability and I say, okay, that was just a visualization. Let's come back. Let's go, okay, what do? And I drink some tea and I eat some sugar and I play some video games and whatever, right? I do all my normal numbing agents to bring my nervous system back to a place of regulation, because that's what we do, right? And then I say, okay, that's one rep. Going through that whole process is one rep. And I come back to the place and I just taught my brain I can go there, I can get that far, and I can come back to safety. I do that rep. And then I do another rep. And I do another rep. And I keep getting as close as I can. And as my nervous system is freaking out, the thing that held me back forever, like years, was because I get to that place. And you know what my thought is? Any guesses? I say it all the time. It's their fault. If I do one rep and I go all the way to the point of like maximizing my discomfort that I'm capable of without losing my shit, and then I'm in that place and I say, how dare they do this to me? Why couldn't they just be different? Why couldn't she just? As long as I'm pointing the finger at the other and saying their actions are the reason that I feel this way, I will stay in that loop forever. At least I did. Years and years and years. It's at the point when you say, you go to maximum discomfort and you say, none of it is theirs. This is 100% mine. Now what is it? And that's when my life changed. That's when everything started turning around and saying, they've got these books, Radical Accountability, Radical Honesty, all that kind of stuff. It's kind of that idea that it's just like, I go all the way here and say, I cannot blame this discomfort on any other human being but me. What is it? Tell me. And you'll probably get crickets chirping because he doesn't want to tell you at first. But so that turns in a whole other aspect, which is like, well, now I've got to earn his trust enough that he'll actually start talking to me, and then that's a whole thing. But you do that, and then you get to the point where you're just like, what is it? And it's just like, I'm terrified of being alone. Do the little sheet where you talk about fears in life. I did this when my marriage was falling apart. And it's just like, and with a therapist and everything, we get down and it's like, my number one fear, any guesses? Yeah, that I'm gonna die alone and unwanted. Like that idea would just send me into the jitters. And I'd like couldn't sleep, and I'm walking around in the middle of the night and everything. So I do all this stuff. It's like, oh, let's go to the gym, let's get fit, let's change my diet, let's cut video games, let's take all my numbing agents, get rid of them, blah, 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 right? Yes, helpful, but not as helpful as one simple thing. Visualizing being alone on a deathbed in some country that I didn't even know and I had no familiarity with, and I have no friends, and I just caught some crazy ass disease, and I'm lying on this bed, and the only people around are the doctors and nurses, and I'm just like, nobody even knows I'm here, I'm completely alone, and I've got another day to live. And you know what? I did that visualization until it didn't hurt anymore. And then I'm free. And that fear isn't even on my list anymore. Like it doesn't even register. And I actually forget that that's still a big one for people. It is one of the number ones. I should never forget that. But I do sometimes, and I'm having some discussion online, and someone's like, well, how do you get over the fear of death? And I'm like, that's easy. You just go there and process it until it's done, and then it's behind you. And it's just like, that fear will sneak into every aspect of my actions and behavior and everything else, and you know what it'll do? It'll make me insanely jealous. Because the reason that I want you standing here making me choose, feel wanted, chosen, and prioritized is because I don't want to die alone. I want to feel like I'm chosen. I want to feel like I have a partner, community, blah, 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 love, love, love. Wait a second. Was I in that relationship simply to get my fix? And I had to ask myself that question, and I don't actually have a full answer for that. Was I in a marriage simply because I wanted someone bonded to me so that they couldn't escape and that would force them into a situation where they would choose me all the time? And the answer is probably yes. It's complicated because 9 years. The way you test that is you say, okay, I just want someone to talk to. Now I'm going to imagine her standing here saying, I'm going out the door to have lunch with my ex and we're going to sleep together afterwards. And now check your emotions. Oh. If I just wanted someone there to talk to, I would have no emotions when that happens. Right? I know some of my thoughts on this stuff are controversial. At this point, I don't care because honestly, I am so convinced I'm right. I keep telling people, I'm like, in 10 years, we will know. Like, there's no way at the rate that psychology, personal development, good researchers and thinkers are getting out in the social media space and actually covering ground at the speed at which it's happening. There's no way that that's happening at the speed it's happening, that the real good info is not going to be commonplace in 10 years. And so in 10 years, we'll know if I'm right. I'm here to help you get past your own deceptions, your own delusional whatever. I'm here to help you face your fear, get stronger, whatever. And what I keep finding with people over and over and over again as we go through this process first they're chaos and they're like, I feel horrible and I don't know why, right? And they usually blame it on an ex. And then we go through this whole process where we bring it inward and they have agency and they start, and then it's like that self-actualization realization thing, that comes automatically. It's like, here, let me clear out all this mud that's holding you down. I'm gonna help you do that. And then they go, poo, and then they like shoot off. And I'm like, okay, that's great. And I'm like, I may not even agree with the direction that you shoot off in, but I don't care. Like what I care about is that you found yourself and you've got personal agency, you've got power, you've got less fear than you started with. And then we help people do that, and it's like that rest of that bit, the self-actualization stuff, it's like they say, what? I don't have to be afraid of everything? And they're just like, I could do all this? And you say, yes, you can. And it's like, I don't know if you get this one, but I get it every time. They do this thing where they're like looking at the possibilities, and they look at it, what they were, and they're just like, are you sure? And I'm like, yes, yes, yes. And they're like, okay. And they do a couple of tiptoes, and then they're, phew, and then away they go. And it's just like, victory, job done, right? And now, you know, they might smash into some other life challenge later where they come and talk to us, but for, you know, lots of times it doesn't happen. Like, they hit escape velocity and they're off. And it's just, that's such a good feeling. It's one of the reasons I teach this class. Lessons we've learned are, jealousy is a fear response to a perceived threat. Jealousy is not about their behavior. It's not about their actions. It's not even about their intentions. It's not the why or the how or the wherefore or which three-letter acronym we can assign to them as a psychological assessment, right? It's not about that. None of that matters. What matters is that, like, their actions hit my nervous system and my nervous system interpreted that as a threat. Why? And then I start there and I dig in and then dig in and dig in and figure out what that threat is. At no point am I saying we allow people to do whatever they want. Actually, that's not true. That's exactly what I'm saying. Allow people to do whatever they want. It's like, what am I saying? It's like, no, that's exactly what I'm saying. Allow people to do whatever they want. And then you decide what your appropriate closeness to that is. You okay? You want to go have lunch with your ex? Okay, sure. Like, I've got difficult emotions about that. How am I going to do that? Do I run away and numb out and blah, 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 whatever, which means we just postpone this conflict and difficulty for later down the road? That's not so helpful. Or I just say, how happy is she going to be when she comes back? And it's like, super happy. Like, well, I like when my partner's happy. And it's like, and if I'm happy when she's happy, it's just like, we could have a really fantastic day. Oh, okay. So you're saying, so she goes off and I'm in a state of trust and we've got this like spoken agreement and we've negotiated the terms of our arrangement and say, yeah, like, you know, this is a monogamous bond and I'm monogamously, you know, I turn down other offers so that I can focus on you. And I, you know, what do we usually do? I say, and I expect you to, that's not right. This is where I am at. I'm at, we're in this relationship, I'm with you, I'm turning down anything else and prioritizing you because you're special to me in all these ways, la, 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 la. Then you wait and you listen. Does she say the same thing? Or she's like, oh, that's cool. I really like being prioritized. I kid you not, I've been in that conversation. Like, and that part of me down here that was so hungry for connection and everything else was like, wow, well, that's unfortunate, but, you know, she's so cool or so hot or whatever, right? And I did not interpret that as a red flag, right? Now I'd just be like, okay, like, big red flag, actually, big red flag, because it either means you got plans or it means, you know, like, you got other options and you're planning on dealing with them, or it means, like, just keeping my, like, I'm well, actually, two and three are the same thing, terrified of vulnerability. Vulnerability and commitment, because commitment is vulnerability. And so you got this person here who's just like, you know, I don't really like to commit, and I don't want to be in the situation where I'm promising anything, because then there's going to be these expectations, and la, 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 la. It's a humongous red flag. So I say, this is where I'm at. Put it on the table. How does your partner respond? You watch how they react to my vulnerability will tell you a lot about their mind space, their personality, everything else, okay? So we do that. Okay, so now let's say that, just getting back to your point, that the partner says, yeah, me too. I'm also in a monogamously committed one-on-one partnership and I'm turning down other offers to be here with you and we're in agreement. Okay, great, yay. Well, then she goes and has lunch with her ex-boyfriend and then you find out later that whatever, you know, some violation of that agreement happened. Now what? That's a good question. It is an option to just be like, okay, I'm done, walk. Like, we had an agreement, you broke the agreement. We could repair, I'm capable of repair, but I don't really want to. Like that sounds like a lot of work. And because now we have a trust wound, and trust wounds are special, and at least I say that. Not everyone says that, but I think that's very strong. Like, other types of relational wounds are different. Trust wounds are special because trust wounds require time and focus, unlike any other type of wound. Trust wound means we need a time of dedicated consistency and prioritization in order for the trust to come back. And it may not. Like I may never trust you again. So if we have an agreement, partner violates agreement, now we've got a trust wound. And I know reconciling a trust wound takes more effort than other things. How special, how dedicated am I to this relationship? That's a question you got to ask. Again, it has nothing to do with the other person. This is a question I have to ask inside myself with me and my inner child. How much effort do we want to put into reconciling this trust wound? Some people say, oh, once a cheater, always a cheater. Who cares? That doesn't actually matter. It's just like, can I get back to them? Or, just a second, or we flip this all around with Esther Perel style and do marriage 2.0. It's just like, oh, well, that's kind of hot. Right? Because you got this other idea, too, that it's just like, hey, sweetie, I'm going to go have lunch with my ex-boyfriend, and we're going to go to his hotel afterwards. And it's like, as long as you give me the videos afterwards, I'll be okay. That is an option. I'm not saying it's the right answer, but I'm just saying there are no relationship police. So if that is something that stimulates you or you can agree on or whatever in some way, I mean, I'm being a little bit extreme, but you get the idea that, like, if that is an agreement you can step into with one another, then why not? Absolutely. And anyone who tries to shame you for that, cut them out of your life. Because you've found a pathway that you're like, this works for me, and it works for this relationship. And it's like, I come from my hometown is like a hotbed of polyamory and stuff. But like, we see all the time that there are people that do it well, and there's people that are terrible at it. Okay? There are people that are doing it for all the wrong reasons. The people that do it well, their trust goes up. And you see this all the time. There is a pathway. Again, it's the question, is it possible for any human being on earth to be in this same situation, standing in my shoes, watching my girlfriend go have lunch with her ex, and that guy would have a different emotional reaction? Yes. And then you say, what's the difference between me and him? He's turned on by blah, 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 this whole dynamic. Is that me? No. Okay. But maybe a yes, might be a yes. We ask the question, right? So anyway, that's a possibility. It's not for everybody. For most people, it's not that. For most people, it's like, I feel safety in this pair bond. Why do I feel safety? Because it's consistency. I feel safety because I've got someone wanting, choosing, and prioritizing me every day, and that feels safe. And it turns out, you need to ask yourself that question. And if that's the answer, then you need to get very real with yourself. Because you say, the reason I'm in this relationship is because I like this feeling of safety, of having a person consistently idolizing me or prioritizing me or whatever. And then I got to ask the question, am I here because they're prioritizing me? How much do I actually like this person? Because sometimes those don't match. And it's very crazy. I actually get this with clients more often than I thought, is that their whole relationship is being driven by, you choose me, and so I'm going to like you back. And it's like, oh, well, you like me back makes me choose you. And then this whole back and forth thing. But if you like slow all that down and pull all the attachment stuff out of it, you realize they're not actually compatible. They're not sharing values, they're not sharing life goals, they're not sharing processing, they're just not compatible. And it's like, of course you're gonna have friction because your whole relationship is built on attachment wounds. You know, I get a lot of people, most of my people that come and see me end up, most of them are coming because they've just gone through a big emotional breakup, some kind of major emotional rupture or some incompatibility. And lots of times, codependency is one of the primary dynamics at play because we're basically taught by roughly every culture on earth teaches us how to be codependent. And so there's this thing about like, you like me and I like you and all that kind of stuff. There's an exercise that I assign to people often, and I've mentioned it in my classes a couple times kind of in passing, but like, we've got the camera and we've got people here. Take on this exercise if you really want to challenge yourself. And that is, again, visualizations, right? Because there's a way to do visualizations, which is you get into the nitty-gritty. It's like, what kind of carpet are you standing on? Is the wind blowing through my hair? What is the, what does my shirt feel like against my left shoulder? Like you pick completely insignificant details and you focus in on it and you say, what does that feel like? Not the story of it, but it's like, oh, it's chiffon and chiffon is scratchy or whatever. It's like, no, like get into it and be like, you're in that body and you say, what does it feel like to have this kind of fabric against my left shoulder? Like get in, and when you do that, like close your eyes, get in a quiet space, no distractions, you sink in and you focus on each of the small details. Keep looking at them, carpets, glass, windows. Windows are dirty. What kind of dirt? Is it a smudge of glass, you know, smudge of oil or what? Get into these insignificant details. And then this is to prep yourself because this increases theta waves in the brain and theta waves increase pliability of the subconscious, makes it more communicable, all that kind of stuff. So we go into a good visualization and then we imagine a polyamorous lifestyle. Here's my partner. And it's not just my partner's walking out the door to have lunch with their ex. It's that this is something that we've agreed upon and we talk about it all the time. And it's something that there's absolutely no shame in it, at least in the context of this relationship. And I can play out in my little fantasized world, my imagined fantasized world, I can play out scene by scene and see which ones trigger me. And again, at the beginning and the end and 100% of the way through, remember these words, it is never, ever, ever about the other person. If I'm getting triggered by whatever's happening, that's me and my wounds. Let's go find them. If you need help, call me. I'm good at this, apparently. You imagine a polyamorous life. You imagine a world where sexual monogamy is not on your menu. And I kid you not, this is the single most effective tool I've ever found at finding all of your insecurities. Again, I come from a hotbed of polyamory. I fooled around, I experimented that road. I mean, there's aspects of it that are beautiful. There's aspects of it that are not, right? It's not better and it's not worse, but it is really, really good at finding all the deep-seated insecurities. Because what does it do? It goes right to that volume button and it goes, we're going to 11. And it's like, ah, right? Drugs. You're imagining the random thing in the room and then your girlfriend walks in and now she's going to have lunch inside your visualization. Yeah. So you imagine all the details to sink into the visualization and then you bring in the triggering events. And then that will trigger you, more than likely. Yeah. Well, it's interesting. Well, there you go. Like, and you can fiddle with it too. That's one of the neat things about these exercises. We can fiddle them and say, well, let's turn it this way. And you're just like, wow, that feels really good. You're like, and then we'll bump into the things where it's just like, I don't feel like I've ever had a right to ask for that. And you playing around this visualization world, you can actually get yourself into situations where you're just like, I would melt. I would melt from pure joy if that situation happened. And unfortunately, I don't believe that I'm in a world that will ever grant me that wish. And that's my wounding, right? But it's very interesting to get into that place and you say, I mean, I've done this a lot and gotten into places where I'm just like, oh, I kind of actually know what my ideal situation is. And now I operate in the world and say, hey world, is there anyone out there that wants to, no, no, okay, well, let's make do with what we got, right? Yeah, maybe that may not be the best path. Don't follow my lead on that one. I'm still figuring that one out. So the question is, how do we know whether or not my ideal situation is being influenced by my childhood trauma? The answer is you do not. That is, again, I said earlier, it's attunement. It's conscious brain being attuned to the subconscious brain. No disrespect for furries. Does anybody know what a furry is? Okay, furry is you go to a convention and you put on an outfit that makes you look like an animal. So you're furry, and then you hook up with other people that are also so garbed, right? Wolf meets Care Bear or whatever, right? I mean, and it's just a thing, right? It's a preference and whatever, right? And it's like, it could be completely healthy and fun And again, no shaming on them, but it could also be driven by something else, right? I'm just using that as kind of an extreme example. But the idea is that it's like you find something that you're into, and like maybe you're really into it. Maybe when that idea comes and is presented in front of you, you're just like, what do we call that? Anybody? You guys have all been here before? No, euphoria. It's one of the four trauma responses. If you see something that comes in front of you and you're just like, and you see the excitement for it just begins peaking out and you're shaking and whatever else. Yes, euphoria. In my world, if you're gonna be in my class and work with me, it's one of the four trauma responses is euphoria. And it is it's the unspoken trauma response. This thing is from the subconscious, the inner child. This thing, whatever it is the pizza that I've been hungry for 28 years. And I didn't get it when I was younger. I've literally been craving it and lusting after it. And somebody walks through the door of that pizza and like my whole nervous system dysregulates, because what is a trauma response? It's something that's dysregulating your nervous system. So trauma responses can go perceptive, like society will say it's positive. Oh my goodness, they're so in love. Oh my goodness, he's so euphoric when he sees his partner. She like melts all over him. Well, test it, because I was that guy multiple times. No, but I had multiple high intensity relationships. Like relationships were so intense that like the community knew, right? And they'd point to that guy and be like, I want to be in love the way that he's in love with her. Like literally, I was like the poster child for like the fairy tale love story. It never works out, because the whole thing is fueled on unresolved trauma. There's no balance to it. There's no calmness. There's no, I was gonna say no safety. There is kind of a sense of safety. But again, what's my priority? My priority is protecting the next generation of children. And children do not develop well. Children that are in a chaotic environment will have issues. And a relationship that is fueled by chemistry and intensity and passionate emotions will not be stable. It will be chaotic. And those children will suffer. Guaranteed. So there is an aspect, oh my God, you talk about like the bizarreness of life is that the thing that fuels sexual romantic connection is the uncertainty. It's I don't know if you like me or not. It's I don't know if this is gonna be safe. It's that I don't know if how awesome this is gonna be. I want, like, is she gonna choose me? Is she not gonna choose me? Like, oh. The thing that fuels that connection, how many times, well, I don't know if you guys hang out in other Ubudian stuff, but they'll talk about feminine, masculine polarity. And it's like, what are they talking about there? They're talking about polarity. They literally say the pathway to romance is maintaining polarity, which is difference, which is I don't know you and you don't know me. And we're these like electrical, you know, lightning rods that are opposite ends. And they're like electricity is shooting back and forth. It is great at creating sexual attraction. It is great at creating intense emotional feeling, but it is not great at creating a safe environment for the development of a child's attachment system. And this is what I'm all about. So at some point in time, we have to transition from the chemistry, electrical arcs going zap, 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 yeah, this feels so good. And we have to transition through this state of mundane drudgery into a point where we say, this is not as exciting, but I know who I am, and I know why I'm here, and I know who you are, and I know why you're here, and we are aligned. And even if we never have another zap of electricity again, I still choose you as my partner, because I value you in all these amazing ways. And if we can do that, we can create an environment where we say, child comes into it and say, I am a complete and whole balanced human being. Nothing will shake me, not even my partner walking out the door. If I can do that, I have become an emotional superhero. And those children will change the world, guaranteed. Well, I mean, that's kind of getting into the philosophical distinction of like, what is relationship, right? And it's just like, in a lot of ways, Well, let me just share something and see if it tracks with people. Is that like, here's you and here's me. And if you're nobody to me, like no person of significance, you're just the homeless guy outside of Burger King, then it's like we don't have a relationship. There's nothing between us, right? But if you're someone of significance, which I choose to make you a person of significance, we kind of birth this third thing, like you're saying. We birth this thing that's like, this is the relationship, right? And now that relationship needs tending to. It needs like to grow and to be challenged and to expand and everything else, right? And it's like, so if we're going to birth this relationship into being, we definitely need to take some time to figure out what is this thing and what's needed for it, right? And that kind of comes back to the lightning rods. Is that if our relationship is being defined as chaotic sexual chemistry, and that's what turns me on this week, great. If there's no children involved, fine. Like, have all the fun. But if you're intending to have children, there has to be a point that you turn off the electricity and you come back to Earth and you say, we can do this in the absence of all the excitement. I know what to do, and I know how to be, and I know how to be regulated in the absence of excitement, in the absence of validation, in the absence of presence. What if my partner gets cancer? In the absence of finances, whatever. Like, you go through the list and you say, can I create 100% solid container of safety for this developing brain if all those things fall away? And if I can't, it just means I've got more homework to do. What I'm saying is when the child comes in, when my birthed child comes into this world, can I create that container of safety that's 100% on? Because that's the truth. When you're a parent, you're on stage 24/7. The general rule is if you can get to 36 months, like if you can be solid for 36 months, everything after that gets easier because the secure attachment system has, okay, back up a sec. What is the attachment system? Attachment system, a lot of people, I talked about this last week. A lot of people have this idea that the attachment system is the way that we bond romantically to other people. I believed that for a long time. Arguably, the definition still works. I know my teacher still uses it, but I'm gonna propose a different thing because when you attach or when you assess for attachment in an official attachment exam, what they're assessing for is something called coherence of mind. They're not assessing for how your romantic life goes. They're trying to assess for how does your brain organize information and is it coherent and consistent with itself? A lot of people with attachment wounds as they're talking, they'll kind of spin off into la-la land. I know I did that for a long time. They will change tense. They'll be like, it was then, and then it's now, or future, or whatever, and they're spinning around. This is my operating definition of the attachment system. Old days, they sold encyclopedias, and you'd have encyclopedia A, B, C, D, E, F, G, and then at the end, there would be this one that's like the index. And I'm looking for sharks. I would reach for the index, and I'd pull this out, and then I'd flip it open to sharks, and it says, open up S, turn to page 375. Okay? The index of all the other information is right here in this little book. The attachment system, this is what I'm going to suggest people think of as the attachment system. The attachment system is the master index for threat. That's what it's doing. The attachment system is a 2-year period of time where this little developing brain is figuring out what is a threat to my existence and what is safe. And wrapped up in that is the whole master behavioral code for how I'm going to relate with another person. Because in those 2 years, I learned what forms of relating are safe and what forms of relating are terrifying. And that's what this is all about. That's why I come back to this idea of it's the threat response. And so giving people a secure attachment system, what we're doing in that 2-year window where we're creating the safe container and why it's so important that parents learn how to do this, is we're creating a container where that child can escape with a clean index of what is actually threatening and what is actually safe. And then they go off with the rest of the world with these lessons ingrained so deeply in their their psyche, that it's their baseline truth. And then walk down the street and they say, oh, here's this person. It's like, this person's yelling at me. It's just like, oh, that doesn't feel good. Like, okay, is this threatening? No, he's actually just some stranger. And I don't know if you've ever seen this happen. I've only seen it happen a couple times, but to have a kid like this big or this big or this big, like, you know, somewhere between 4 and 8, and the kid will witness a dysregulated adult and just be like, oh, well, he must be having a bad day. It's just like, I hope he gets better. The child does not respond, this screaming out of whatever crazy adult, the child doesn't respond as if that's a threat, because they're just like, I mean, yeah, if it got too close or touchy or whatever, right, they would respond differently. But when it's just that person over there yelling and screaming, getting angry and honking horns or whatever, the kid's just like, it's like compassion. And it's this felt sense of safety in this world. The child believes, because their attachment system tells them, I am safe in this world. And because whatever happens, I've got a support network, I've got a system, whatever, blah, 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 blah. We can explore that more. But the child that has that deeply ingrained gets to do all the stuff. They don't have fear holding them back. They don't have fear canceling off relationships or making them isolate when, you know, they get rebuffed at the dance or blah, blah, blah. You know, they don't hide behind the couch during Shark Week or whatever, right? They don't have fear as a fundamental primary driving force in their life. And that's why this is the greatest gift we can give another human being. So that's what I'm all about. Jealousy is a symptom of my unresolved attachment wound. Use it to find those wounds, dig them up, and process them. The sooner I can release them, the sooner I can be in this relationship with this other human without fear being the driving force. And if I can do that, I can actually relate to them as they are, not as a projection or a symbol of what they are. They stop being my source of heroin. They start becoming an actual human being. And then you're like, woo, okay, you wanna go do the thing? That's not where I wanna be. Okay, this is not where I wanna be. Like, please go do the thing that is great for you. Like, if that's awesome, I totally support that. But I don't wanna be close to this. I don't wanna spend my time and energy in this dynamic. No judgment on you. There's nothing wrong. You haven't done anything wrong, and I'm not judging you, and you're not less than or anything like that. Like, you're still awesome, and I like you as a human being, but I want to spend my time somewhere else. Right, but what are feelings? I talked about this earlier. Feelings are a motivator. Feelings are an instruction that comes from this guy that says, I want you to move closer to that thing or further away from that thing. If you've got big emotions that are coming up and hijacking your system, that means you have not processed the wounds related to that stimulus. That's like, I don't like black and white statements, but that one has been like, approaching this process with myself and other people through this lens has been incredibly rewarding and consistently bringing people to a place of resolution and freedom. It's that, like, those emotions that you're feeling are coming from the wound center. Let's go find the wound and pull it apart a little bit, because what we want to be to the place where it's just like emotion. Like, I can feel emotions, like, yeah, it doesn't feel good, but it has no control over my system. It's just information. It doesn't feel good. Why does it not feel good? Well, it doesn't feel good because it reminds me of this other situation where I was abandoned. This one's different. You're a different person. You're not my mom, much as my inner child wants to think you are. You're not my mom, and you're going to behave differently, and you're going to act differently, and I'm going to react differently to how you treat me, and it's just like, you go through that kind of whole thing. Because the person that says, I'm sorry that's painful for you, but I'm gonna go do this thing anyway, that's not the person that you wanna have a long-term connection with. That's not the person you wanna invest your time and energy with, because the person that says that will keep saying that. I have witnessed people that change their behavioral expression, but they're changing their behavioral expression because they're afraid that that wife is gonna walk out the door. They're not changing the behavioral expression because it's a true representation of what they feel on the inside. They're just like, oh, I need to sweep every day for you to not leave? Okay, fine, I'll sweep every day. I will unfollow these people. Like, it's this, and that's a fear response. And that's That's bringing the whip to the lion cage and saying, I'm going to whip you into submission until you behave the way that I want you to. And this is coming from someone that did it. I did that. I also had it done to me. It's not fun. It's really not fun. Even, because again, it's this whole thing. I'm going to subtly and passively aggressively punish you endlessly until you behave the way that I want you to. Yay, it's been 3 years or 4 years or whatever. Now you finally do it. Ah, we're so compatible now. And then she chooses to stand next to me. And then I'm just like hanging out with my guy's friends, just being like, I don't know if she really wants to be there. Is she doing it just because I told her? You know, it's like, no. You want to be in the place where you're just like, you got complete freedom and you know you have complete freedom. And then you choose to stand next to me. It's like, sweet, let's party, right? Let's go build something together. Let's go have adventures, lots of good, whatever, emotional, blah, blah, blah. And let's go build something great. And then that's a power couple. Because both people can just be like, ain't working for me, peace. I'm leaving. And the other one's like, okay, peace. And it's like, let's go, right? I got other things in my life. It's tricky though. Humans are extremely adaptable. That's what this whole gray matter thing up in the brain is all about. If you take a developing brain and you put it in a state, in a location, an environment of like total chaos and hostility, that brain will figure out ways to survive and find safety. And so there are situations where it's just like, yeah, there's violent abuse happening every day, every week, whatever. And it's normalized because they don't know anything different. And it's like, okay, that's super tragic. I don't believe there's any kind of like higher power or anything that's like guiding this stuff. I mean, in the sense that like there are people who'd be like, oh, those children really know deep down that that's wrong. It's like, that's not always true. We got tons of evidence that backs that up. Example, okay, I mean, uncomfortable, stop me if it gets uncomfortable for anybody. There's this book called The Boy Who Was Raised as a Dog, and it's this man who was, well, they found the child in a dog kennel. And when they go through the backstory, they find out that it was the child's mother had some mental illness, and then she connected with a man who was equally mentally ill, or also somewhere on the mental illness spectrum. And he lived far, far away in the rural, out in the woods. And they all went to live together. And then she had a baby, and he was like, I don't know what to do with this. And then she died. And he's just like, I don't know what to do with this, but I do know how to raise dogs, because that's what he did. He like raised dogs and like would care. He was a breeder, and he would take these dogs around to people that would like buy these dogs from him. He's like, well, I do know how to raise a dog. And he's just like, well, it kind of looks like he eats the same and whatever. And he did not have the mental faculties to put together that this is a different thing. And so he basically just raised this baby as the way that he would train a dog, and kept in a kennel, da 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 da. This went on for like 7 or 8 years before the child was found. And he was literally living in a kennel and behaved as a dog, acted like a dog, made sounds like a dog. And they're just like, what? And it is tragic, and he went into a whole host of, you know, therapy and help and all that kind of stuff. And last I heard, if I remember correctly, that child actually came through pretty well, all things considered. But it does highlight that if you take a human brain and you put it in an environment where there's a certain amount of consistent normalcy to it, even if that seems crazy to us, that brain will adapt and find a way to survive. And it's just like, so you can take a child and put it in a situation where there's like way too much abuse or uncertainty or whatever, that child will find a way to survive. It doesn't mean it's going to be healthy, but it's going to survive, because that's what the subconscious cares about. Does this organism survive another day? Yes, victory. That's all it cares about. Does not care. The subconscious does not care that you're happy. It does not care that you have a good wife or life or relationship or satisfied or spiritual. It does not care about any of that. What it cares about is survival of this organism. Ah, that is a vast field of research in psychology, special behavioral and childhood developmental psychology. And they've been researching it for about 50 years. And there's some very, very smart people that have, and some of those are the people that I follow that this stuff is based on. And it's like, it does seem to be that resilience is everything. It is teaching, okay, oh man, I'm so, apologies if this is controversial for anybody. Again, it's like I don't like black and whites, but I'm gonna give you another black and white. A parent that teaches, that instills in a child a black and white truth or wrong, a right and wrong, is weaponizing shame. There's no out from that. Like, the parent that challenges a child into a greater degree of resilience and they keep doing that over and over and over, that child is gonna go whoosh, because they're capable of more and more stress, which means they're capable of riskier business decisions. They're capable of more processing more data before their brain becomes overwhelmed. They're capable of standing in the face and saying, I'm sorry, sweetie, I have to have a hard boundary for this, and if that means the end, that's okay, because I am capable of dealing with the discomfort that happens when she leaves, right? Greater, in my opinion, parents have two responsibilities. Create a secure attachment style, which means a clean index of threat, and a continual 18-year process of increasing that child's resilience. That's the job of a parent. You'll notice I did not say the word love, because that word has so many meanings. It's effectively meaningless. And at the end of the day, if I do this, if I say, hey child, I know the five pillars of attachment, and I know the things that I need to do so that you feel wanted, chosen, and prioritized every single day, and you're attuned to, and I support you every time you're dysregulated, and you will never experience shame or blame in my presence, that I will express delight at your very existence, not for your performance. Your very existence brings me delight. I give you a chance to be autonomous, and that child always feels safe in my presence. Again, I never said love. You think that child feels loved? Yes, most of us would. And this is one of the reasons why when I found this thing from Daniel Brown, it like lit up all the stuff in my brain, because I'm just like, love is such a meaningless term, but it's like, here we've got a systemized, codified way of evoking all the things that seems to be every human desires. Every human desires these five things. And if I can do that with my child, I do amazing things for that child. If I can do this to my romantic partner, good things will happen. And if I can do that to my own inner child, good things will happen. Right, so we're running out of time. I did have an exercise I wanted to do. And then the challenge is to sit with this person. First thing you do is you attune to self and you say, how terrified am I right now on a scale of 1 to 10, okay? Then the next thing you do is you say, you find some aspect of your life that evokes jealousy, that here's something that I have and it's gonna walk away. This doesn't need to be something that's actually happening. It could be like, I'm with this person, I care about her very much, blah, 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 and if she were to walk out the door right now, I would feel it. I would feel big, difficult emotions. And that can be as simple as that, right? So probably start with someone that you don't know, connect with this person and say, 1 to 10, how terrified am I? Describe to this person the thing that if I lost it, it would evoke big, difficult emotions, and then witness that. Okay, fourth thing, you come back to the first one and you check in and you say, how terrified am I right now? After my partner's done sharing, I share one again, and then it goes back and forth. You start with one, let your partner go, and then comes back to you, see if you can find another one. And if you run out, you say, there's nothing else I'm afraid of losing in this world, dig deeper. And if you dig deeper and you still find nothing, then you're probably done. Welcome back. We're a little bit over time, so we want to close up quickly. Thank you all.
Thank you.
I saw connections happening. Thank you for that. I really hate to cut that off, but please do this exercise with more people. Like in my world, in this room, or at least wherever it is I'm teaching, vulnerability is defined as being in that place where I'm out of control and I'm afraid of it. And so being in a place where I am telling you the thing that I'm terrified of and I'm connecting with that fear is by definition a vulnerable expression. Vulnerable expression, for whatever reason, touches human psychology in a way that it draws people towards you. Be vulnerable, learn how to be vulnerable, and in the process, you also desensitize yourself to fear, which means to be vulnerable the next time you actually gotta go deeper. So it's a nice reinforcement loop. Do this exercise regularly. So go to someone in your life and and share with them something that you are afraid of, something that brings you dysregulating fear, and watch what happens. That relationship, if it's healthy, that relationship will deepen. If it's unhealthy, there will be drama. And then make your, then choose. All right, thank you very much. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. Wow, claps. As you all know, To Mind Method on all social media and the website, tomindmethod.com. Do you feel like we actually covered the topic of jealousy? Yes, yes, yes? Okay, good. Good, excellent. Thank you all for coming. See you next time.